Welcome to this edition of CBN News Weekend. I'm Lori Johnson. 100,000 children sexually exploited every year here in America by human traffickers. But there are only around 50 shelters to help the ones who have been rescued from that cruel business. And these survivors need support to recover from the terrible trauma they've suffered. As Heather Sells reports, that challenge is huge and expensive.
For 13 years, sex traffickers tricked, manipulated, and sold Hannah. She endured until it became clear they might kill her.
I gained to realize that the people didn't love me nor care about me. As a matter of fact, they would have traded my life to protect their own lives.
She arrived at this Christian trafficking shelter both scared and excited.
I immediately felt safe. I immediately felt like I was in a part of a family.
But Hannah is the first to admit her months of recovery have been painful.
This program hasn't been easy.
Victims of trafficking have usually experienced major and persistent trauma. It's comparable to what we know as PTSD. So because their injuries are so deep and sustained, the rehabilitation process is lengthy.
She has already been living an unstable and traumatic existence. Then you add the trauma of being trafficked, the violence, the neglect, the deprivation, the coercion, and that creates a complexity of trauma.
4 years ago, Jean Allert began the Samaritan Women, a Christian shelter for survivors of sex trafficking. She and her staff provide around-the-clock intensive care.
We're dealing with the threat, the history, her skills or lack thereof, maybe medical issues, mental health issues, and it's really the whole person and her whole life. So when people say, what are your services? Not so facetiously, we say everything.
The latest national estimates show around 50 shelters providing care for trafficking victims. Roughly 2,000 beds exist, not nearly enough for the tens of thousands who need them. Experts say money is one of the biggest obstacles.
The programs that are really doing the best job cost a lot more than the programs that may not have specialized services to survivors of trafficking.
And research is the other hurdle, hindering both fundraising and program effectiveness. An American Psychological Task Force recently found no reliable estimate of the trafficking of women and girls in the U.S. It also found that providers need systematic, high-quality research to determine what works and what does not. These challenges have taken a toll on trafficking shelters. At least 5 have permanently or temporarily closed in the last year.
There's a lot of burnout. We have a lot of people who want to help, don't know how, and then it's frustrating for them.
In just 4 years, the Samaritan Women organization has learned a great deal about what its women need. At first, it's all about making them feel safe, both physically and emotionally.
She has to know she's going to eat every day. She has to know she's not going to be violated while she's sleeping.
Then women must learn who they are. That's because traffickers usually lure young teens and literally stunt their psychological development.
Even though chronologically she's in her 20s, we're starting at 14, and we're picking up on the lessons that you learn during those stages of your life.
The final step, women must decide what's next. For many, that means working on their education. For others, career goals. Hannah loves to mow the shelter's large property with the hopes of becoming a forklift operator someday. She credits relationships in the shelter with giving her the strength to press on.
I know that they would do anything in their power to see me succeed. Knowing that, it keeps me strong.
The APA Trafficking Task Force is calling for survivor-informed research to help pave the way for women like Hannah. It also wants to explore the role of faith in the recovery process. It's an enormous challenge, but as Allert notes, providers can also build off a core resilience shown by survivors.
She's already survived through a lot. So we've gotten an individual into our care who's already proven that they have tremendous strength. So for us to treat her with complete kid gloves as if she's unable to care for herself, I think disrespects the fact that she's already demonstrated she might be stronger than you are.
Picking up the pieces of these broken lives is expensive, complicated, and emotionally draining. But providers add that doing nothing puts young souls at stake and adds long-term costs to society for those who never heal. Heather Sells, CBN News.
And Heather joins us now. Great reporting, Heather, and it's just such an important issue. It's heartbreaking, but also on the same token, it's very encouraging, too, to see these shelters. We need more of them.
Right.
What was it like being in one?
It was intense. They're small. It's not like 100 women in a shelter. It's a lot of staff working with the women. I also noticed that it has a kid-like feel, and we alluded to that in the piece, because a lot of times these girls have grown up in chaotic homes. They've been trafficked while they're teenagers, and they really need to go back to their childhood. They need to watch Disney movies. They need to read kids' books.
Wow.
And really reach into their childhood before they can move on as adults.
That's really fascinating, and I loved how you sort of compared what they went through to PTSD.
Mm-hmm.
And I would think that even more so, because everyone, when you're on the streets, is an enemy.
Mm-hmm.
And what are they going through, these victims?
Right. Well, and it's interesting when you think about PTSD and the adrenaline that, say, a soldier would go through. Well, they've gone through a similar adrenaline rush in that. Like Hannah, she never knew when someone was going to come through the door and basically rape her. So now she's got to adapt to a life where she doesn't have adrenaline, where she lives a so-called boring life, knowing what her day is going to look like.
Fascinating. You know, we need more journalists like you telling this story. What motivated you to do it?
You know, I have seen a lot of Christians really concerned about human trafficking, wanting to do something but not knowing what to do and not realizing how complex it is to start a shelter. So that was one of my concerns. And another is just the lack of research. If we've got an issue that's being compared to PTSD, we need a lot of scientific research to know how to work with these women, and we don't know that right now. So I'm hoping that a lot of educators and researchers will take the ball and run with it here.
And all Christians would love to pray for these victims and for the people trying to help them.
Mm-hmm.
How can people pray?
You know, one of the thoughts I had was pray for the staff, because for them to ingest these stories and really walk alongside these women is incredibly hard. So pray for the women, but pray for the staff.
They were talking about the burnout. I can definitely see that. Well, Heather, things are getting better in the fight against human trafficking.
We have a national report card that just came out that shows more states are getting A's and B's this year in recognition of new anti-trafficking laws. And the laws have improved dramatically in just the last 4 years. Take a look.
Shared Hope International began grading states on their anti-trafficking laws in 2011. Simply put, the states bombed, with failing grades going to more than half.
In just 4 years, state lawmakers have responded, passing laws that impose heavy penalties on both traffickers and buyers. This year, Shared Hope gave half the states A's and B's, and not one state failed.
A lot of that is due to grassroots activities. Public awareness has increased significantly over the years.
Two bright spots include North Dakota and Montana. In recent years, the booming oil industry brought in more than 100,000 workers to the Bakken region, and crime spiked in both states. That led Shared Hope to fail North Dakota and Montana back in 2011. Today, their grades have improved to a B and an A.
With improved laws and greater enforcement, buyers and traffickers become aware that this is a much riskier endeavor to engage in, and it will deter demand and trafficking.
What's still needed across the board, help for victims, especially in the areas of protection and services. Shared Hope wants all states to strive for A's and B's so that traffickers will not be able to simply move their operations.
And Heather's back with us again to talk more about this very important issue. And it reminds me of the drug trade. Obviously, the traffickers are going to go to the states where there are the most lenient laws.
Yeah, I was at a conference last year, and a number of survivors told me, yes, our pimps really knew the laws, and they would threaten to move us to if, you know, they needed to. So they were really monitoring the laws.
Okay, so where do the states most need to improve?
Well, we've got half the states that are doing pretty well, but all of them, really what they want to see is more laws, more work in the area of victim services and protection. So this is a good report, but there's also a lot of work to be done.
So a lot of these major events are big places for human trafficking, like the Super Bowl. We know that the Super Bowl is going to be in California next year. What are the laws like there?
Believe it or not, California has been at the bottom of the heap for the last 4 years in this report card. Their laws are not good, which may catch a lot of people by surprise, but the Super Bowl is not catching the authorities in California by surprise. So they're working with Shared Hope and other groups to really try and be proactive so that traffickers won't see the 2016 Super Bowl as just an automatic place to go.
Opportunity. All right. Well, thanks for the information, Heather. And you can follow Heather on Facebook and Twitter, as well as her blog, Newsroom Talk, on CBNNews.com. Up next, learn how to survive in the wilderness. Wendy Griffiths shows us what to do. Don't go away. Imagine your car breaks down in a remote area and you're all alone. Or you're hiking and you suddenly become lost and your cell phone isn't working. Would you panic or would you be prepared and to survive until rescue comes? Wendy Griffith takes us on the mountain with an inside look.
Welcome to Mountain Shepherd's Wilderness Survival School, located in the beautiful and rugged mountains of Southwest Virginia. Here, Reggie and Dina Bennett train military and regular folks how to survive the worst-case scenarios and live to tell about them. The Bennetts focus on seven main survival skills: positive mental attitude, first aid, shelter, firecraft, signaling, water, and food.
Most people think that finding food and water are their top priorities in a survival situation. But actually, it's building a safe and secure shelter like the one behind me that should be your first order of business.
Because the environment is going to do you in a lot quicker than most anything else.
Reggie, a former U.S. Air Force survival instructor, showed us how to take a simple plastic sheet you can buy almost anywhere, a piece of sturdy string, and in no time, you've got shelter.
What's great about plastic is very forgiving. Even if it's not perfect, it's still going to work for you.
And this time of year, the forest floor gives you all the stuffing you need to make a comfy mattress. CBN videographer Rachel Hooley and I were determined not only to make our own shelter, but to sleep in it.
Hey, it's working.
Hey. I'm very excited about our mattress tonight. Look at this. This is gonna be better than a hotel.
Well, we are here, snug as a bug in our tent. Here's Rachel.
Hello.
How does it feel?
It's cozier than I thought it would be.
It rained during the night, but our shelter kept us warm and dry. Another vital part of survival, especially in winter, is fire. Fire serves a number of purposes other than simply keeping you warm. It allows you to cook, boil water for drinking, keep bugs and predators away, acts as a signaling device, and supports the number one survival skill, keeping a positive mental attitude.
But what would happen if I threw that right on my tinder? What would I be doing to tinder? I'd smother it. So see, this is where the platform and brace comes in. You put the brace next to your platform like this, right next to the tinder. Then you take your first kindling, bunch it up nice and tight, and you set that right over top the fire. If you see any smoke, it's saying, Reggie, I need oxygen. And all you have to do is just lift the brace up.
I chose the flint and steel method to make my fire. I used a cotton ball smothered in petroleum jelly as my tinder. Vaseline, hand sanitizer, even chapstick makes a cheap and easy accelerant in an emergency situation.
So if you come out into the woods and you don't have an accelerant to start your fire, you can simply take a very sharp knife and scrape it and create what's called like a fluff, which makes excellent tinder.
Fellow survival classmate Sage was successful using just fluff from the wood and a fire starter to get her blaze going. Now for one of the most important elements of survival, water. The average person can only survive about 3 days without water. You can survive 3 weeks or more without food.
Your body is about 75 to 80% water. So you are gonna get dehydrated really quick if you don't keep sipping that water. Remember what we say here at our school, ration your sweat, not your water.
If you're in a situation where you don't have water purification tablets and cannot boil the water, try to find the entry place where the spring is coming out of the mountain, like this one.
The water's coming out of the ground right there. See it? So it's being filtered through this ridge, hits this area, and comes out right there.
This provides your best chance of drinking the water before it's contaminated by animals and other bacteria. And last on the list, but not least for most of us, is food. Reggie showed us how to make a squirrel trap with a simple piece of wire.
And I'm just going to funnel him right into my snare.
This time of year, edible plants are scarce. Fortunately, the forest provides plenty of edible bugs. The best way to eat any insect is to cook it. Worms, grubs, termites, crickets, and beetles are your best bet. Although today, we went for what we could find, the popular wood roach.
Oh, look at this. It's a buffet. See, I told you when you find one, you usually find a huge family.
So in a survival situation, if we were really hungry, this wood roach would be an excellent source of what?
Of the fats, the carbohydrates that you need in a survival situation.
Okay.
Which you're not gonna get from plants. So I'm not saying don't go after plants, but these are readily available. They're all over the world. If you use those rules that I taught you, this is what you need.
Okay, so we're gonna roast them.
Uh-huh.
All
okay,
right.
Okay, so we just roast them, because they could have a parasite on there. So we'll go down there in the flames.
Nice and cooked. Okay, I can't believe I'm doing this, but in a survival situation, this little roach would be a great source of fat and carbohydrates. Tastes like a nut.
Yeah, like a nut.
It tastes like a really tasty nut.
Yeah.
So wow, very nutty.
So you've just got over those food aversions, and now you're going to survive.
Reggie,
all right,
thank you.
You're welcome.
Wendy Griffith, CBN News.
And after the break, we'll hear firsthand how that bug really tasted. We'll be right back. I don't know, Wendy. Welcome back to CBN News Weekend. Well, before we went to the break, Wendy, we saw you eat a wood roach in survival class.
My first wood roach, my first bug of any kind that I know of. We've probably eaten a lot of bugs in our life, not unknowingly.
Without realizing it. Mm-hmm. I know I've been riding my bike before with my mouth open in one way,
yeah,
out of my mouth, but that's another story.
It's bound to happen.
But actually, there are, people shouldn't go out and do this without proper training, because there really are some bugs you shouldn't eat.
Yes, don't eat bugs with more than six legs. I never knew that. Of course, I'm not like normally eating bugs, but if you're in a survival situation, stay away from bugs with over six legs. Stay away from bugs that sting or bite. And if they're brightly colored, stay away from those too, because that's sort of nature's signal of don't eat me.
Mm-hmm. Very interesting. Yeah. Well, with this class, I mean, you were sort of under the assumption that you had some basic tools. What are the basic tools that any hiker should have?
Well, you know, and it's funny because I hike all the time and I usually don't take a knife with me, but boy, I mean, this is your number one survival tool. This is good for everything. Mm-hmm. This is just a little one. And the one in the piece was a little bit bigger, and it was great for scraping the log to get the fluff for the fire. But this can do a lot. You can dig with this. You can find food with this. You can, you know, God forbid you have to protect yourself. But, you know, and you can cut rope. You can, you know, if you're injured, so many things you can do with a knife. You know, if you're out, especially if you're alone, this is great. You know,
right?
Because
whistle.
You know, might be injured. You might be, and you might need this in a reflecting mirror. I don't know if we can pick. Oh, we can. Mm-hmm. Look at that. Ooh.
All right. So that's another way of getting help.
Yeah, and also, I never thought about this. This is cool. This is a normal trash bag. Mm-hmm. Of course, it's blaze
orange.
You can use this for so many things, Lori. You can use this to make a quick shelter. You can cut it, and it will, you know, separate and keep the rain off. Or you can use it, you can make a hole for your head and make a poncho.
Poncho, yeah.
And because it's blaze orange, it might get someone's attention. And of course, you want to, you know, if you're going hiking, even in your car, this is a great little sack. It's really lightweight. It has all these things in it, a fire starter, other things, and of course, chocolate. No survival package should have. This is a power bar. It has protein in it, but you know, I think chocolate is a survival aid. So this would go in here, and there's even a little flashlight on here. This is so cool. And this actually is waterproof and holds water. You can get this at the Mountain Shepherd's website, and this is their wilderness kit, and it tells you all about what's in it.
Well, did you guys really spend the night in that tiny little makeshift tent? And didn't you say
really
it rained?
We really did. It rained. And you know that mattress of leaves that I thought was going to be so comfortable? Mm-hmm. Not really.
Not so much.
Not really. It actually got pretty hard because you're still basically on the ground. I mean, you do have the leaves. But I wish I had put a foam mat on top of my sleeping bag, right, and then I think it would have been better. But we were dry, we were cozy, and we didn't get wet in it. Hey, that's why they call it roughing it,
Lori. That's right. That's pretty good for roughing it. Well, do you think you're going to be going on any more outdoor adventures anytime soon?
Oh, I hope so. And I feel a lot more prepared now. Uh-huh. And I am, you know, from now on, I'm not going to go without some of these great little handy tools.
Right. Great advice. It reminded me of Girl Scouts. I'd love to do that just to see if I could do it, because it's been a long time since I've been in Girl Scouts.
You could do it. You're in great shape. You work out. I know you could do it. Let's go.
All right. Wendy, thanks so much for joining us, and we'll be back right after the break. What if you had to go to school in stifling heat, do homework with little to no light, try and focus when you're also starving? Well, that's what's happening in Haiti.
We had children that were fainting in school because of the heat and coming with an empty stomach.
Next week, Caitlin Burke tells us what ministries are doing to feed the hungry and help the Haitian children be able to pay attention more during class. That's on the 700 Club on Monday. You won't want to miss it. Well, that's all for this hour of CBN News Weekend. You can find more of our exclusive coverage of the issues you care most about at cbnnews.com. And stay up to date with CBN News through Facebook and Twitter. We hope you'll join us again next time. Have a wonderful weekend, everyone.